Hi everyone, welcome to Gateway Lectures. Here are the solutions for the quiz day 8, and here is your first question. Today's subject is about machine design. A cantilever beam is subjected to completely reversed bending moment. So it is a type of completely reversed fatigue loading, and the bending moment value was given as 200 Newton meter. The log diagram of the SN curve is given for the beam, and the diameter D of the beam for a life of 10 power 5 cycles is. So this is actually a rotating beam test, and from the output of the rotating beam test, the log S log N curve is drawn. And by observing the curve, we can say that it seems to be like for ferrous materials. Generally for ferrous materials, after 10 power 6 cycles, the curve becomes asymptotic. I mean, it doesn't show any symptoms towards the number of cycles. So whatever be the number of cycles, the endurance limit remains the same. So it seems like a fatigue loading diagram is for ferrous materials, right? So just we will here the matter is not about what type of material. Just to understand the question, we've said that it is a ferrous material, but here we need to calculate diameter at 10 power 5 cycles. So let us take 10 power 5 cycles. So what is meant by exactly 10 power 5 cycles here? So when n is equal to 10 power 5, okay, then log n base 10 will be nothing but log 10 power 5 base 10. That is equal to 5 log 10 base 10 is 1. Therefore, it is equal to 5. So we need to mark a point at 5. Let's suppose the 5 is somewhere here. This is our 5 point on the log n axis. So we need to draw a straight line from 5 meeting the curve at a point, and at that point we need to calculate the value of S, nothing but the value of the stress, or the value of the stress should be calculated at this point, and the value of stress is nothing but the value of the bending moment, because here the type of load is bending moment load. So here the type of stress induced will be bending stress. So here we need to calculate log S, let that be some S dash, whatever we need to calculate at that particular 10 power 5 cycles, base 10. So we need to calculate log S dash base 10. We can hear this, we can solve in two methods. One, we can use similar triangles method, then the other will be interpolation. But since it is a visual diagram problem, we'll use similar triangles, it'll be very easier. Suppose this point be A, at this point be B, whatever we need to calculate it. And this point be C, and this point be D, and here the point be E. Generally, this wherever 10 power 6, the line becoming straight line, this is the endurance limit. Generally, this will be the endurance limit, but here our matter of concern is not about the endurance limit. We need to calculate the value of S dash. From that S dash, we need to calculate the diameter value, right? So here we have taken A, B, C, D, E points on this curve. So let us see what were the similar triangles. What were the similar triangles here? ABC, triangle ABC and triangle ADE are the similar triangles. And we know for the similar triangles, the ratio of height to base should be a constant. So first consider triangle ABC. What is the height? For triangle ABC, the height is 2.687 minus log S dash base 10. Upon what is the base for this ABC triangle? It is nothing but 5 minus 3. Similarly, that should be equal to the other similar triangle height to the base ratio. So for ADE triangle, the height is 2.687 minus 2.093 upon the base here is 6 minus 3. So by solving this, we will get the value of log S dash 10. Nothing but a 10 power cycles, the value will come out to be 2.291. Once we remove the log, then S dash will be 10 power 2.291. And that value is nothing but 195.434 Newton per mm square. In the question, nowhere it is said the units, whether it is Newton per meter square or something, but we assumed it to be Newton per mm square. Generally, we will not be using a shaft which is having a diameter of 10 meter or 10 meter or 20 meter. We'll be using a shafts which are having diameters in mm, sometimes inches and centimeters, right? So we assumed it to be Newton per mm square. Okay, generally the S value here taken is for Newton per mm square, right? Nothing but a megapascal value. Since it is megapascal value, having a large value, mega means 10 power 6, 10 power 6 times the Pascal. So what we do is, to reduce the scale of the diagram, we apply log to that S value. So 195.434 Newton per mm square. We got this. And in the question, we know this is the bending stress. Whatever S dash we got, that is the bending stress at 10 power 5 cycles. If suppose the material fails at 10 power 5 cycles, then what will be the bending stress at that point? And also given the bending stress can be given by, and this is the maximum bending moment at the 10 power 5 cycles. Okay, and the bending stress can be given by 32 m by pi d cube, right? So therefore, bending stress sigma b max, that is equal to 195.434 Newton per mm square, is equal to 32 into the value of, and it is 195.434 is in megapascals. That Newton per mm square means megapascals. So we will convert that into pascals, into 10 power 6. And 32 into m value was given in the question as 200 Newton meter upon pi into d cube. So every parameter is known. From here we will get the value of d as 21.8 mm. That is close to 22 mm. Right. And this is our answer. Next question. Maximum tensile stress sigma max induced at the edge of an elliptical hole. So this is our elliptical hole given in the question. We need to calculate the maximum tensile stress acting at this edge. This is our edge. Okay, we need to calculate the maximum tensile stress at this point. So nothing but edge of the elliptical hole. For that, major axis is given as 4 mm and the minor axis is given as 1.5 mm in a flat plate. So generally, this question, these types of questions are questions for discontinuities in geometry. Since this is having discontinuity in geometry, we will be using geometric stress concentration factor. We will be using geometric stress concentration factor. What does exactly geometric stress concentration factor mean? Due to discontinuities in geometry, the stress value at that discontinuity will be the maximum. Or it will not be equal to the nominal stress acting at the minimum cross section area. Okay, geometric stress concentration factor, and it is denoted by KT. Right, so KT is said as maximum stress at the discontinuity. Maximum stress at discontinuity upon the nominal stress at the minimum cross section, or else simply we can write it as nominal stress. And here in the question, nominal stress is given, nothing but sigma t, acting at the other cross sections or throughout the cross section except discontinuity, right? That is nominal stress. And generally for this type of elliptical discontinuities, the kt value is given as 1 plus 2a upon b. This is a empirical relation, there is no proof for this. For our syllabus, we don't discuss the proof and things. Just remember, for spherical or circular, we'll be using 1 plus 2ab upon b. 2a upon b. So what exactly is a and what b is? The 2a is called as the length of the major axis, or it can be called as major axis. 2a is called as major axis. And similarly, 2b is called as minor axis. Right. And the values were given for 2a. Major axis was given as 4 mm. And the minor axis 2b is given as 1.5 mm. But in question, we need the value of b. So from this, b is equal to 1.5 upon 2 mm. That we'll substitute here. Kt is equal to 1 plus 2a is 4 upon 1.5 upon 2. And that should be equal to the sigma max, whatever they have set to calculate, upon the nominal stress given in the question, sigma t. So from here we'll get the value of sigma max as 19 by 3 times sigma t. This is a basic question for this. Suppose if it is a circular cross section, for circular hole, suppose circular discontinuity, Then for circular discontinuity, the value of 2a is equal to 2b, and that will be equal to the diameter. Then the kt will be nothing but 1 plus 2a upon 2b, nothing but 1 plus 2. Right, 2a upon b, na? 2 into a is 2a, and b, the things were equal. So then 1 plus 2 is nothing but 3. Okay, this is our answer. For circular cross sections, we will directly using kt as 3. And going to the next question. Spur gear has a module of 3 mm, number of teeth is 16, face width is 36 mm. So we'll just write the given data. The module was given as 3 mm. We know module is nothing but diameter upon number of tooth. Number of tooth is given as 16, and the face width generally is denoted by b, is given as 36 mm, and the pressure angle is given as 20 degrees. It is transmitting a power, so here we are transmitting power with the help of this spur gear, 3 kilowatts at 20 revolution per second. Taking velocity factor, generally velocity factor is given as CV, that is equal to 1.5, and the form factor generally will be denoted by Y. That form factor is also called as Lewis form factor if we use Lewis formulation. Okay, and generally the form factor is nothing but thickness upon 6 times H into M. But generally here we need to calculate if anything was not given, but here directly form factor value is given as 0.3. And the permissible bending stress, sigma b permissible, is given as 200 megapascals. We need to calculate the beam strength of the gear. So what exactly is beam strength? Suppose if you consider this as our gear. Right, what are the forces acting on the gear? We'll see what will be the forces acting on the gear. On the gear, there will be a tangential force, okay, and also there will be a radial force, and for both of them there will be a resultant force acting. That resultant force will be always along the pressure line. So if you consider any point on the gear, there will be two forces always acting on the gear at the point. Okay, one is called as tangential force, FT, and the other is called as radial force, right? So which force is responsible for power, and which force is responsible for thrust? Thrust, FR is responsible for thrust, and it should be the minimum. But FT is responsible for torque transmission, or else power transmission. So here the beam strength is nothing but the value of FT. Okay, so always remember, beam strength of gear is nothing but FT, right? So how to calculate FT? There is a lot derivation for this, but directly a scientist Lewis gave an equation for this. By Lewis equation, the beam strength of the gear, it is generally denoted by SB, is given as MB sigma B into Y. Okay, you remember this. Only remember this formula, it is enough. There is a derivation for this, but it is not that important for us. This is given by Lewis equation. So SB is the beam strength, M is the module, B is the face width, and this is the B. This is called as face width, and this is the thickness T. Right. Sigma B is the bending stress permissible. Y is the Lewis form factor. So in the question, the M value is given as 3 mm, into the B value is given as 36 mm, into the sigma B is given as 200 megapascal, nothing but 200 newton per mm square, into the Lewis factor, it don't have any units, it is 0.3. And if you can observe here, mm and mm, here mm square gets cancelled, and from that we will get the value of beam strength SB as 6480 newtons. And this is our answer for beam strength. That is option A. Next, going to next question. Shown below is a bracket fastened by means of four identical bolts. So there are four identical bolts, and also the nominal diameter of the bolts was given in the question, 10 mm. Two at A. So at A we are having two. One we can see from the front view, and the other is behind this A bolt which we are seeing. So let us name these bolts, number these bolts, okay, exactly. So this be one, this be the bolt one, and here this be the bolt two, which is facing to us. And behind this, there will be another bolt 2, sorry, 3. 1, 2 was named. The other bolt behind this is 3. And here also we'll have another bolt behind this, that is 4. So there were 4 bolts, 2 at B and 2 at A. Okay. Maximum shear stress induced in the bolts. So among any bolt, what will be the maximum shear stress induced due to the given loading condition? We need to calculate. And this is our bracket that was supported by the bolts, and the rod which is here being loaded is called as, generally called as, tie rod. The rod which is an accessory to the bracket is called as tie rod. So here, if you can observe, for the tie rod, when we take the components of the forces, the 10 kilonewtons whatever load we are applying, if we take the component for that, we'll be having two components. That will have the two components, one among the x direction and the other among the y direction. See, if this is 30 degrees and this is, this will be the 30 degrees. So once we resolve them into components, once we resolve into components, these were the components on the bracket. This will be P sine 30. Nothing but the value of P is given as 10,000 newtons. So 10,000 into sine 30 is 0.5. This will be coming out to be 5,000 newtons. And this value along the horizontal is P cos 30. Okay. And that value comes out to be 10,000 into cos 30. And that comes out to be 8,660.25 newtons. Right. So the effect due to these both loads, one horizontal and one being vertical. Since here due to space constraint, I am also using the previous page. So first, effect due to, so here you can see this is P sin theta and this is P cos theta. Effect due to P sin theta, let us suppose P sin theta. So what will be the effect due to P sin theta? It is a load along the longitudinal axis of the bolts, nothing but perpendicular to the plane of bolts. Then such type of load will be always the tensile loads on the bolt. Okay, so this effect due to P sin theta is, on each bolt we'll be having a primary tensile load, because this load, whatever we are seeing here, is along the longitudinal axis of the bolts. This is the longitudinal axis and nothing but it is perpendicular to the plane of bolts. Then that type of load gives primary tensile load. The primary tensile load will be denoting it as P dash. And if it is on first bolt, it is P1, and it is on second bolt, it is P2, on third bolt P3, on and fourth bolt P4, and that value is equal to P sin theta upon 4, because that load will be distributed by all the four bolts equally. So the P sin theta value is, we calculated 5000 upon 4, that is nothing but 1250 newtons. And next, effect due to P cos theta, right? So P cos theta we can write as, this P cos theta is parallel to the plane of bolts and perpendicular longitudinal axis. Then it creates two types of effects on the bolt cross section. One will be direct shear stress. So one will be direct shear stress on each bolt. Direct shear load instead of stress, we can say shear load. Direct shear load on each bolt. Generally shear load we'll be denoting it by PS. So PS1 here is equal to PS2, is equal to PS3, is equal to PS4, and that will be, again this P load will be distributed equally among all the bolts, and that will be equal to 8660.25 upon 4, and that comes out to be 2165.06 newtons. And there is another effect due to this P cos theta, we will discuss it here. Other effect is secondary tensile load. This occurs due to tilting of the member. Here the member is the bracket. See, in the question, the values were given. This edge is C and this edge is D. Okay. So this edge is C. Since the load is acting along this direction, the bracket tends to tilt about this point in this way. So whatever bolt which is close to the tilting edge, this is the C is the tilting edge, close to the tilting edge will have the least effect. But whatever load which is far away from the tilting edge will have the highest effect. I mean, it will have the more elongation produced. More elongation, nothing but more load will be acting on that. So the secondary tensile load, what we are talking about, will be the maximum on the bolts 1 and 3 rather than on 2 and 4. So the effect of secondary tensile load will be more on the 1 and 3, predominant on 1 and 3 rather than on 3 and 4. Oh, sorry, 2 and 4. Here is the 2 and 4. See, because the elongation is more here. And so delta L1 is equal to delta L3, and that is greater than delta L2 is equal to delta L4. If the load, the elongation is greater for the same material, the load will be greater. So we need to calculate the secondary load acting on 1 and 3. So how we will calculate that? Generally that we will be doing conventionally, it takes time. We need to take a moment about tilting edge. We need to equate them. Again, we need to apply the shear stress condition here. Everything, but finally I will write the equation what it will be. You can refer some standard textbook or else any class notes here. P, since it is secondary, we denote it by double dot, and at it is acting at 1 and 3 bolts. So P1 double dot, nothing but P3 double dot, and that value is equal to, what is the load which is responsible for this secondary tensile load? P cos 30. Therefore, P cos 30 into the eccentricity. So here you can see the eccentricity. This is our eccentricity 100 mm. Mean the distance between the point of application of load and the plane where the bolt is supported, okay, into E, into the length from the tilting edge, length of these, the distance of these bolts from the tilting edge, from here to this. So here we can observe, that is nothing but 50 plus 200, that is 250. Nothing but, we can write it as L1, 3. Upon, generally it is L1 square plus L2 square plus L3 square plus L4 square, whatever it is. But here L1, L3, L2, L4 are equal. So directly we can write them as 2 into L1 square plus L2 square. Right. So we'll substitute all the values. P1 double dash. Then we'll take P1 double dash. And that is equal to P cos 30, 8660.25. Into the eccentricity is 100 mm. Into the L1, 3 is 250. Upon 2 into the value of L1. L1 is, we already seen, 250 square plus L2. L2, if you can see, that is 50 mm. So the distance between the tilting edge and the bolt, that is 50 mm. So 50 square. From here, we'll get the value of secondary tensile load. And that value comes out to be 1665.4 newtons. Right. Now we got to know that the bolts 1 and 3 are the critical bolts. Nothing but the bolts which are prone to fail faster. So we need to make a design for those bolts which are critical in nature. So we'll make for critical bolts. So for critical bolts, so what is the total value of the, we can directly now calculate the stress, or else we'll simply first we'll do the load, tensile load, and then we'll calculate the stress. So the total value of the tensile load acting, nothing but the primary on the first one, nothing but first or third, plus secondary. Since here we got the primary tensile load, and here we got the secondary tensile load, this value. So we'll add those both, and adding those both we'll be getting a value of nothing but 1665.4 plus 1250. That will be getting it as 2915.4 newtons. So on the critical bolt, the tensile, total tensile load was known. Then we can calculate the total tensile stress acting on that bolt. Then that can be written as 2915.4 upon area of cross section of the bolt. This is all about tensile. Then what about the shear? on the bolt there is a primary tensile, secondary tensile, and also a direct shear. So what about the effect of direct shear? Yes, and that value is we've already calculated 2165.06 newtons. Then what is the value of tau due direct shear due to this PS? Nothing but 2165.06 upon the shear area. Here is nothing but the cross sectional area of the bolt. These whatever we are calculating for critical bolts, these will be generally considered at the critical cross sections. So what is the critical cross section of the bolt? The cross section where the bolt and the support, see here, this is our bracket between the member and the support. This is our member, and this interface is our surface to which the bracket is bolted. So this cross section here, this cross section is a critical cross section. So mostly failure occurs at that cross section. So that is a critical cross section. Now we will analyze what is the effect of sigma t and tau acting at there. So we will take an element here. We'll see an element here, and this is a biaxial state of stress. So we'll represent just a plane. On the plane, if you can observe, the tensile load is acting downward. So whatever tensile stress we have calculated, sigma t, it is acting downward. And here it is sigma t. And also the shear, direct shear, is acting along this direction here, and also this direction here, and also here in this way, and here in this way. If you can observe there at the cross section, if I take a cross section of the bolt which is into the support and which is into the bolt, here at this point, this bolt, this part of the bolt tries to, due to the load, that due to the shear load acting, it tries to move the bolt in this direction. So we considered a point here. If you consider a point here, then on that point the shear stress will be in this direction. To complement that, there will be an opposite, and for these both complementary, there will be an opposite forces acting, right? In this way we have drawn the tau value here, right? Once So once we have taken this element here, this is the element we have considered, right? For that element we can analyze what will be the maximum shear stress. In the question we were asked to calculate the maximum shear stress induced in the bolts. So for maximum shear stress, it is nothing but the radius of the Mohr circle. So what is the radius of Mohr circle? When the sigma x or a sigma y is given, sigma x is 0 in this case, and tau xy is given. So when these for this type of loading condition, the maximum shear stress is given nothing but the radius of the Mohr circle, and that is equal to under root of sigma x minus sigma y by 2 whole square plus tau xy whole square, right? From that we'll write here, we need to calculate the value of tau xy. So that is nothing but equal to sigma x is 0. So it is sigma y upon 2 whole square, nothing but sigma t by 2 whole square plus tau xy is nothing but tau here in our case, tau square under root of, and sigma t is nothing but 2915 upon 2915.4 upon a is nothing but pi by 4 into the diameter is said to be taken as 10 mm nominal, 10 square plus, and to this whole square, and also here there is a 2 plus tau square. Tau is nothing but 2165.06 upon pi by 4 into 10 square and to its whole square, and it is, this is all under root, okay? every value is known, then we'll calculate the value of tau max, and by calculating the value of tau max we'll get the answer here as 33.23 newton per mm square, and this is our answer. Since due to space restriction it was very clumsy, but try to understand how we have taken all the steps here, and try to understand how we taken the elements here and how we represent the stress on the element. Once you represent the stress on element, then everything will be easy, whatever it may be. If they say to use calculate maximum shear using maximum shear stress theory, even then we can solve that. Okay, well, taking an element is very important here. Next, we'll move on to the next question. Shown in the figure is a single block break. The intensity of the pressure between the block and the brake drum is 1.5 newton per mm square. The dimensions of the block are 40 mm into 80 mm. The coefficient of friction is 0.25. Then they're asking us to calculate what is the value of hinge pin reaction. So this is our hinge pin. Let that be some point A. Hinge pin reaction for clockwise rotation of the drum. The drum is rotating clockwise. So initially, first we need to understand one term here. The intensity of pressure between the block and the brake. Who will apply the pressure on the brake? Nothing but the brake shoe. On applying the pressure, the load P, the brake shoe will apply a pressure force on the block, nothing but the drum. So this is the block here. So this is the block, or we can even call it brake shoe. So we will call it as block, and this is our drum. So block applies pressure on the drum, and what will be the magnitude of the pressure? Nothing but the normal reaction. So first we will see the FBD of both the block and drum. So if you can observe here, we'll do the FBD for this, right? So at this point, we'll take two for this member, for the block. At this point, we'll be having a frictional force, and also, so if on the block it is in the towards the rightward, then on the drum it will be towards the left, right? Similarly, on the drum there will be a normal reaction acting. Due to this normal reaction, on the block also there will be normal reaction acting upward. Right. Now we'll represent what all we have learned here. This is mu into n. How will you get the direction of mu into n? Suppose the block is drum is rotating. Suddenly you brought the shoe in contact, or the block in contact with the drum. What happens? This drum tries to pull the block towards the right side, because this is rotating clockwise. So since it is trying to pull it towards the right side, that pull is due to the friction between the block and drum. So the effect of friction is right side, therefore the frictional force is towards the right side, mu n. If it is right side on the block, then it will be left side on the drum, and also the normal reaction n, and the same normal reaction will be acting on the block also. And coming to the hinge reactions, one will be the vertical reaction and one will be the horizontal reactions. The horizontal reaction is, let it be Rx, and the vertical reaction be Ry. So first we need to calculate all the values. Finally, we were asked to calculate the resultant reaction forces on the hinge. So first, for that we need to calculate what is N, what is P for the given conditions. So for that we need to use the pressure intensity. So the pressure intensity, due to the pressure intensity, it will be developing a normal reaction between the block and the drum. We've already discussed what the pressure intensity mean. So normal reaction and normal force. Pressure intensity is newton per mm square, nothing but force per area. So here the pressure is P into the area is 40 into 80, nothing but the cross-sectional area of the block. And the pressure here is 1.5 into 40 into 80. 4 is 32, 3200 into 1.5 is nothing but 4800 newtons. This is the value of N. Once N was known, in the question N was known, now we'll apply moment about hinge. We know always the moment about hinge will be zero. So hinge point is, I named it as A. So the moment about hinge A is zero. Now we'll take all the moments on that block, on that FBD of this block. Okay. Once we take the FBD of the block and lever, for the block and lever, P, about the point, P is anticlockwise. So minus P into the distance is 350 plus 250, 600. And N is clockwise, so plus N into distance is 250. And so the frictional force is anti-clockwise. So minus mu n into, and the distance is given as 70 mm in the question. And that must be equal to 0. In the question, n was known, mu was known. We can calculate the value of P here directly. N will be substituting 4800. Mu is given in the question, that is 0.25. Then we will get the value of P. We will get the value of P as 1860 newtons. So here we have obtained the values of N and also P. Then also if N and P are known, then frictional force mu N will be also known. Since mu is known, N is known. Now we need to apply, since the if you consider the liver block system, that is a system with coplanar non-concurrent forces. All the forces, if you apply, they doesn't meet at a point, but they are all coplanar non-concurrent. For coplanar non-concurrent forces, we can apply three equilibrium conditions. One is sigma m about any point is 0, that already we have used here. And next I will be applying sigma fx is equal to 0. For sigma fx is equal to 0, if you can observe, it will come out to be rx is equal to mu into n. Nothing but mu is 0.25 into the value of n is 4800. And that is nothing but 1200 newtons. Similarly, we will apply sigma fy is equal to 0. Once we apply sigma fy is equal to 0, we will get it as p plus ry is equal to n. From that, we will get the value of ry as n minus p. N is 4800 minus 1860. From that, we will get the value of ry as 2940 newtons. Right. So it is 2940 newtons. Now we need to calculate, since Rx we have got, Ry we have got, we need to calculate the total reaction, resultant reactions on the hinge point. So the resultant reaction on the hinge point is nothing but under root of Rx square plus Ry square. Nothing but under root of 1200 square plus 2940 square. And that comes out to be 3175.5 newtons. This is our answer. Thanks for watching. These were the all five questions for today. This is on machine design. Only these type of basic questions will be asked in GATE in machine design. Not much greater than this. We'll be solving many questions in the upcoming quiz and also in upcoming numerical shorts. We'll be doing many such questions. Only one thing is important. Once we know the concept, we learn the concept clearly, then everything will be easy. Once we get through the concept clearly, everything will be easy. Keep practicing. Daily you keep at a target of practicing at least 15 to 20 questions daily. Suppose today you started with 15 questions, then tomorrow you increase it to one question. Or else for 3-4 days you do only 15 questions daily at least. Once after 1 week you get that habit of doing questions, then you improve it to one other 5, then it will be 15 plus 5, 20 questions. So in that way we will be improving our questions. In within 1-2 months we will be in a range where we will be doing 50 questions per day. That in 3-4 months we will be in a way where we will be doing 100 questions a day. That is more than enough for this examination. Main important thing is focus on concept. Once concept was clear, then everything will be clear. Whatever be the question, we can just do it in less than a minute. Right, we can solve it in less than a minute. Even these type of questions, this type of question here, what we have seen here, this bracket and tie rod case, and also bolted supports. If once concept was clear, you solved at least 10 models on this, then if you see this question, within 2 minutes you can completely solve to the final answer. It is nothing much important more than this. Right, these will be the questions being asked in GATE and also in DRDO. I've seen many questions will be in this range only. These type of block and break questions will be given. More important thing is in DRDO examination, more will be numerical part. So numerical depth will be more in the questions. So there'll be more numerical data in the questions. So you need to solve such type of questions. Thanks for watching. Stay updated. We'll be doing many such important questions and follow this daily quiz.